People with good credit score, CRED has some rewards for you. A credit card payment platform, the CRED app, basically rewards you for paying your bills on time. If you have a credit score of 750 or above and have a credit card, download the CRED app to make your credit card payment experience rewarding. You will get reminders, statement analysis to know about hidden charges and even get CRED coins every time you pay your bill. You can use these coins to avail jackpots and cashbacks on the app and even get discounts on their hand-picked curation of electronics, food and beverages, luxury travel and many more offers. Folks, welcome to Paisa Paisa, brought to you by CRED, the most rewarding credit card bill payments app and powered by Quarter. I'm your host Anupam Gupta, B50 on Twitter, and after a long time, we've got a new bank on our show, and that too, one founded by the creators of Google Pay. Lucky is that? Really got lucky this time. My guests are the co-founders of Fee Neobank, Sujit Narayan and Sumit Gwalani, co-founders at Fee Neobank. We're going to talk about neobanks, savings, millennials, and much more, right? After this CRED convenience break.
$100, that's all it takes to begin your journey with Bitcoin and Ethereum. No, really. With CoinSwitch, you can start investing in over 100 cryptocurrencies with just 100 rupees. On top of that, there are zero charges for deposits and withdrawals, so you can trade, buy, sell, however and whenever you want. All of this, plus their extremely intuitive interface, makes CoinSwitch the perfect app for beginners in the crypto space. But don't take my word for it. Just download CoinSwitch for free and try it out for yourself. If you'd like more information on cryptocurrencies, tune into A Show About Crypto with me, Rohan Joshi, my new adventure on IVM Podcasts. CoinSwitch, kuch to badlega.
Sujit, Sumit, welcome to Paisa Paisa. Thank you so much for doing this for our listeners and for our listeners. Sujit, you first, so that our listeners get your voice. Sujit, welcome.
Hey, Anupam. Delighted to be here. Thanks for having us.
Great. And Sumit.
Hey, Anupam. Great to be here too. Thanks a lot for inviting both of us.
Love this phonetic sound between the two of you guys, Sujit and Sumit. You know, a little bit more close and we would have the same name almost. So let's jump into this. Yeah, you know, what are two really successful, you guys rolled out what's probably the most successful payment network based on UPI, of course, in India, that's Google Pay. So could you just give a brief background into both of you, you know, where do you guys come from, what did you do, and then a two-line, you know, background into Fee. I think it's called EpiFee at some point of time, and now it's called Fee Neobank. So let's, five. And I'm like stuck in that Fee thing. So FI is like Fee to me. So all yours. Take it away.
Hey, so I'll go first. My name is Sujit Narayanan. I'm a banker who joined Google about 10 years ago. Worked very closely in the financial services domain and then bumped into Sumit. And we kind of were looking at places that we could create impact. And we felt that payments, you know, could be a great space for Google to get in. And after nearly 2 years of convincing, you know, the powers to be, both of us got approvals to kickstart a small incubated project, which became Google Pay. After working for a few years on that, we started looking for the next space that we felt both of us could collaborate, bring something to life. And that was how Fi was born. Sumit?
My name is Sumit Gwalani. I would say most of my career actually at Google. Before Google, spent 3-4 years in a startup and then worked on multiple products on Google from way back Google Desktop and Toolbar to being one of the initial members of Chrome devices to Android in India to finally actually starting Google Pay with Sujit. So it's been, you know, a great journey. And as Sujit mentioned, right, like after we built and grew Google Pay, it was time to take, you know, to a much bigger financial sector and create an impact in people's lives in their entire finances. And that's how Fi came about.
And what is the deal out here? You know, you guys explain this to me. You know, there was one time when to get into finance, you needed to have like a chartered accountant degree, MBA finance, this, that. And here I've got someone who's saying, listen, you know, I actually developed a Google search bar. And from there, I went into payment. So what is coding like, you know, the thing, you know, like you, everybody who wants to get into money and finance and investment, they really need to know coding. Help me out here. I'm a chartered accountant. I have no idea about coding. The way it looks like everybody's going to code, man. All All money is code. Sorry, I'm going off track out here, but just help me out.
One of the great minds in the world said, right, software is going to eat the world. So I think, Anupam, it's only a matter of time where you'll see some aspect of software, whether it's electric vehicles, to finance, to music. There is some aspect of software design, product, communication. I think all of it comes in. It's just that the more than software, I think the world of technology, for instance, is getting deeply ingrained into all of our lives, right? So I would say it's more of technology taking a turn towards finance.
Agree.
Yeah, somewhere I'm guessing that Skynet is going to take over and dominate us. Anyway, let's not go so much off track out here. So, okay, let's build the use case, you know, from what I think are two broad areas. First, you guys already built one of the most successful payment apps in India. What, in your opinion, was the opportunity in banking? You know, when you guys decided one fine day, okay, let's get into banking. Why did you not get into investments or lending or any other part of fintech?
Yeah, so the way that we look at it, we'll get into all of those parts, right? Like, but let's take a step back. And if you actually think about it from a very layman perspective or a consumer perspective, right? The entire financial services industry is basically four very simple things from a consumer perspective. One, I want to store my money. It earlier used to be the piggy bank or under the thakia, which then became like the, you know, the bank account. I want to use and transact with my money. Think of all things payments, from ATMs to wallets to UPI. The consumer sentiment is it's my money, I'm using it. Form factors have just changed. The third sentiment is I want to grow my money or I want to invest my money, right? Like consumers start thinking that it could be a house, it could be gold, it could be stocks, mutual funds, crypto, anything. And the fourth is I want to borrow money, right? So now fintechs over a period of time or companies have entered the market from one of these segments, either payments, lending, investment. And everyone in the market wants to be a horizontal. You start with lending, but then you want to do payments and then you want to do investments. We felt that the best place to start the journey of a horizontal is I want to store my money, right? Because fintechs haven't been in that space. There's been fintechs in all other spaces. It's been solved to a greater extent. Banking has been one of those last vestiges, you know, of old school ways of operating from a consumer lens, right? And we felt that is there a way that that can be the starting point? It's now the most difficult starting point because to convince people to store their money is not an easy task. But if you're able to actually successfully navigate through, you know, that challenge with consumers, then moving across to lending, investments, everything becomes fairly seamless. The second aspect was from a consumer perspective, there's loyalty. We tend to bank with the same bank for tens of years, for instance, whereas we keep jumping between other services. So if you can start from a place where you're earning trust and loyalty, for instance, then it becomes easier to build a horizontal across financial services and then start impacting people's lives, right? So that was the thought process in our mind when we started off. We felt that that's a great opportunity for us to partner with a bank and recreate that whole experience for consumers.
It's interesting, right? Because a bank is your primary portfolio. Your entire financial journey starts with a bank and then everything else follows. And, you know, therefore it's very sticky. Bank accounts are typically very sticky. People don't open them very easily, unless I think in the last 1 year, thanks to the pandemic, opening a bank account online has become quite easy. Anyway, so there's one thing that stands out in whenever I read about Fee or whenever I read about the stuff that you guys have put out there in the press, or if I look out your website, demystify. Okay, so for our listeners, can you help us understand why is finance so complicated? I mean, of course, I understand from my perspective, but I want your thoughts on the need to demystify finance for all of us.
So, you know, this is something that we hold very close to our heart, right? Like when we actually think about financial services and the millennial generation, we realize that there was a significant gap. Today's generation perhaps is a lot more evolved, confident about choices that they make in any space. You ask people to wax eloquently on holidays, technology, food, dieting, fitness, and they can speak for hours. you ask today's generation to speak about finance and people take a step back. And one of the reasons is essentially that, you know, from childhood, we are not taught about finance the way that we are taught about trigonometry, or for instance, as the joke goes, you know, mitochondria is the powerhouse of the cell, right? We all start thinking about finance well into adult lives after being forced into it. The second is, while information is there, it's considered to be boring, it's complex, it's not easy for us to understand. And there isn't a path of upskilling ourselves, right? We all learn to play music, we learn, you know, coding, as you said. We learn languages, for instance. But very rarely will you actually see somebody who's not studied finance actually starting to upskill themselves about the world of finance. That was one of the important aspects that we felt, that it's not only about creating a product, but it's also about making things really easy for users to understand and not get caught up in the complexity or the jargon of financial services that's usually served up to users. So for us, we've taken that to heart. We've said, whether it's our app, whether it's something as basic as our terms of service, our employment, you know, what our employees actually bring every day, whether it's a customer service call, is simplification. Because when we think of finance, immediately there's some level of inertia, fear, for instance, and we tend to make mistakes as a result of it, right? So for us, that's very important as we keep building out a product, that we simplify this for consumers, because there are no get-rich-quick schemes, as you know, right? Like, everyone has their aspirations. It's a multi-year journey, for instance. You need to stay the course. And one of the ways that which people will stay the course is if they understand finance really well. It's simple, right? It's simple. If you de-jargonize it, for instance, and you are able to explain it how you would to a teenager, I think all of us would be masters of finance. But the simple fact is that it's so full of jargon, it's complex, we don't understand terminology. Convince, confuse has been the mantra to the largest extent in the industry. The people have stayed away, right? And we tend to make mistakes as a result of that. You can call it our early thoughts. I think we as individuals have made those mistakes time and time again. And our thought was that it shouldn't be so complicated. Financial product should be simple. If we can decide how to buy complex gadgets by simplifying them into simplified parameters, then financial products should also be as simple as that. So that's been one of our corporate missions as well, saying that we want to keep an eye out on this and ensure that we do justice to the space.
Very interesting. So one of the things that a bank account helps us, actually is one of the most basic and most important things, is savings. Savings then essentially decides your entire investment journey, and savings, as we know, you know, it's nothing but income minus expenses. So I want to hear from you guys in your view. You know, we spoke about why finance is a little bit complicated for all of us, but make this specific. What are the biggest, call it mistakes, call it gaps in our behaviors that result in us not saving as much as we can and as we should save? And how technology then helps us to fill in these gaps.
Great point, right? And this is something that we have spent a lot of time, you know, talking to people, doing tons of research to figure out what are those behaviors, what are those gaps where people miss out with respect to savings, right? And if I were to start with, the first and the most biggest one is inertia, right? It's always like, you know what, I will save it next week. I will do this next month. I'll do when my next salary comes. I'll do when my bonus comes. And that never happens. That is the biggest starting point for a majority of people. That's why the number of people, you know, things get caught on in savings and investments, but the number of people doing that is so less. So that's one, first. Second is, you know, just awareness, right? I want to be aware of what's there in the market in that sense, or even before I get, I want to be aware of what my financial situation is. Am I, you know, at the end of a month, where am I spending X on? Where am I spending Y on, right? Like, how much are my food expenses? How much are my, you know, travel expenses? And where can I save and how much can I save? What's my risk potential, right? In the jargonized way. And so to unjargonize that, can we make people aware of where they are, how much they should save and, you know, how, right? So that's step two. Third is this, as Sujit mentioned, there's so much financial jargon out there. Once I decide, okay, I have to save. Third is just the lack of understanding of where would be the right places to save, right? How much I should put in investment, how much in stocks, how much in mutual funds, how much in like a deposit. How do I decide that and how do I understand that? And the fourth one, right? Most people have irrational expectations. It's, there is no, you know, big, rich, quick schemes out there. So you have to be patient. You have to save for a long time. You have to invest for a long time. And that takes time. That takes patience. So that's the fourth behavior that I would say is a gap out there in most people.
In fact, Anupam, if you actually think about it, right? I think the analogy that I give folks also is like health. All of us know what it takes to be healthy, right? Wake up, go for a jog, eat. That's amongst the most difficult things, right? So all of us want six packs, all of us want to lose weight, right? But it takes some amount of effort. And I think that's where technology can help, because putting it all with the user and expecting them to, you know, do everything is difficult. Technology design should actually be able to help you, nudge you, take those steps, make that easy, for instance. And over a period of time, that's our expectation, that we use the best of technology to not only make choices available, but slowly nudge people towards taking those rational calls.
And I just like it when people mention patience. So the way the stock market is going, people are like, I'm already financially independent and retired. And I was like, oh, wow. Okay. I don't think that's going to happen. You know, I didn't think it was that easy, but hey, it's a bull market. Let everyone enjoy this. Folks, so on that note of patience, right, let's take a credit convenience break. My guest, the founder of Five New Banks, Sujit Narayanan, Sumit Kualani, we'll be right back after this really short break.
Folks, we have a listener's question.
Hello, Anupam. I miss listening to the conference call of a company that I track. Where can I listen to the recording?
Okay, that happens to a lot of us, you know, because come on, quarterly results happen 4 times in a year and they get bunched up together, and there's a very good chance that you will miss out on listening to one conference call or two conference calls. And where do you go for that, right? I mean, you know, you want to listen to the entire playback of the conference call and probably you want the transcript also of the conference call. Well, there you go. You've got the Quartr app. That's Quartr. And on the Quartr app, you can create a list of your favorite companies. And wherever the company releases, right, the transcript and the recording of the conference call, the Quartr app will have that. Just open the app, check out your company, and it will show there, right? Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. And you can listen to the entire recording of the conference call, of course, with pause, rewind, stuff like that. And wherever it's available, you'll even get the transcript of the conference call. So, folks, that is a Quartr app, Quartr.
And welcome back to this episode of Paisa Paisa. My guests, the founders of Five New Banks, Sujit Narayanan and Sumit Kualani. Guys, let's start on your product. Let's jump into it. First, you know, Epify, Five. How did you guys start on that journey? I mean, and if I look at your website right now, I think it's still in some amount of development phase. So let's just start with the product. Tell us something about it.
So, you know, we just right before the break, we talked about, you know, the gaps and inertia, right? So yes, we are a neo bank. We, you know, we provide you the standard features of a savings bank account, debit card, deposits. But what are we doing differently to help with some of the gaps? Yes, we are in the early days, but what we have done is exactly try to tackle some of the gaps that you talked about, right? Let's take the first one, which was inertia that I mentioned. Now, as I said, the biggest thing is to get into the behavior of savings. How do we make savings more fun, more cool, in a sense, to do it? What we have brought is a concept called fit rules. Sujit talked about health. You know, we're talking about financial fitness here in that sense. And how do we do that? So what do fit rules? Fit rules says you can decide your own financial rules when you want to put money aside, when you want to save. So you when you're in a good mood, when you're ready that you have decided you want to save, you do it and set a rule up. The money then gets saved automatically for you. Let's take an example. You know, it's cricket season. The test match is going on. What if I can put a rule saying every time Kohli hits a boundary, I save 100 rupees aside? Or, you know, what we just saw recently, right? Olympics, whenever India wins a medal, big thing, let's save 5,000 rupees aside, right? Or, you know, the more normal things. I go and spend that big basket at Amazon. Whenever I do that, keep some money aside, right? Just make it part of your day-to-day activity, something that just happens for you and can be done so that you don't have the inertia. It happens. All you know is it's done. And at the end of the month, you have a ton of happy users who have actually saved aside money that they would have never done otherwise. That's one. Mm-hmm. Second, we all ask questions. If I ask you, right, how much did you spend in that Goa trip before the pandemic? And we'll be scratching our heads as to like, wait, I have no idea. I have to go download 2 bank statements for 2 years and then figure out what did I do, right? Or for example, I want to figure out how much did I spend on Amazon in the last year during the pandemic. All of this can be done with what we have launched is Ask.fi, which is India's first financial assistant that can help you all these queries either by typing or just speaking to it, where you ask any financial questions and you will get that literally in the split of a second. That makes life very convenient. So that sort of understanding, you want to know how much you are in debt, what loan you have, again, you can start asking those questions. That's two. Third one is, you know, this whole ability of communication, which we talked is jargonized. How do you simplify that, right? And as Sujit mentioned this earlier, is that from terms of service to everything we have the app, we try to simplify and make it so that a fifth grader can understand, right? And that's really what we want to do, right? We also combine this with nudging you to take the right actions. So while everybody out there wants to give you reward to spend, pay more, we help you to reward you when you actually save. When you're taking the right actions, we nudge them to take the right action because that's where we want people to go.
Okay. So just a few things here to understand the specifics, right? So one is these analytics and every, you know, detail that you're telling me will, I'll get to know that if all my payments are routed through the bank account, right? Whether it's through UPI or debit card or NEFT, whatever. So first is that. Am I right in assuming that?
Yes, now. But, you know, we will change that shortly too. But for now, yes.
I mean, what I'm saying is basically if I use, say, you know, a credit card of XYZ bank and I just make a payment from the FI account, then it won't be able to show unless I, you know, grant access to my credit card or stuff like that. Or
yes,
just throwing this in the air. Okay, got it. But obviously, I'm guessing that if in the future you also provide me with a credit card, then you have the capability to bring down the detail even for the credit card, right?
Exactly.
Okay, understood. And the same thing for investments again, that, you know, all these building blocks will come as you add the products in the process, right?
Yes.
Chalo, theek hai. I really like your website. I really like the stuff that it's got out there. So just tell us about the sign-up process, because right now I think it's an early access product, and there's something on the Android that I just saw, so just walk our listeners through what's there. Today is 12th August, right? By the time this episode airs, probably be, you know, 1 or 2 months down the line. But what's your timeline looking like?
So Sujit can talk about the timelines, but I'll just give you a quick view of what our onboarding experience is, right? It's a fully digital online experience. You download the Android app, enter couple details like your PAN number, date of birth. We check your, along with the partnership with our partner bank. The partner bank helps verify all your KYC information that's already centrally available in databases and verifies your Aadhaar number. And within literally minutes, your account, a fully digital account, is open and ready. And a card is shipped to you, which reaches to you within 3 days. So you're all set to go. That said, you can start using your digital card right as soon as the account is open. You can transact across the board with UPI, IMPS, NEFT, RTGS. And the good thing is you don't even have to worry which protocol to use. We make RTGS and NEFT as simple as UPI.
By the time, we today have a few lakh people who are on our wait list wanting the nice product, right? So that caught us also by surprise that there was, you know, without doing much, we actually got so much of inbound interest. By the time this episode airs, as of today, we're giving access to a few thousand people every day, right?
Wow. Yeah. A few thousand people every day.
every single day, right? So yes, I mean, by the time this episode airs, we'll be on iOS, we'll be on Android on the Play Store. People can just download it. Right now, we give access only to working professionals. We think that people, who are working, whether they're self-employed salary, that's the segment, for instance, that would appreciate our product a lot more. And over a period of time, we'll build out features which make sense for students and other categories as well. So yeah, by the time this episode airs, you can just go on the Play Store or I just download it from the App Store and you're good to go.
Right. So when you say working professional, obviously you mean, salaried and non-salaried, as long as they work, right?
As long as they're working, yes. Okay. Because all of the products that we're shipping out, for instance, right, as Sumit said, the ability to, I think over the next 2 months, we'll have the ability for you to link all your existing bank accounts, all your, credit cards, maybe over a few months' time. So the power of information is going to be made available to you. Our idea was that could you have an Alexa equivalent or a Google search equivalent experience just with your money? So, hey, it's tax filing season. I need to find out how much of interest I've accumulated from this account. Maybe it's the only point of the year when you look at that number, right? So all it does is for you to either talk or just type that out. And in a jiffy, you could have that answer.
Whoa, just roll back that. Did you say that I'll be able to link my other bank accounts here? I mean,
yes.
That sounds damn cool. You guys want to just give us some sneak preview about how that will work? Because I think that, it sounds damn interesting.
Yeah, so there is a new protocol that we're working on. We're amongst the early adopters of this, which allows for all information of consumers with consumer consent to be made available real time. And I think that's the next leap of financial services. While we created a savings account and we've got investments coming up, we've got cards, lending, all of it coming up, we realize also that for users, managing multiple bank accounts, credit cards, UPI, wallets, it's a maze. Can we actually create one dashboard for all of that information real time, right? So that's the beauty. You'll have to, I think in the next 60 days, you'll be able to actually see this where you can link all your bank accounts and all your information. Imagine our ability of being able to give you one consolidated bank statement across all your bank accounts.
And that would be something, right? Because in our experience, and maybe you guys can talk about yourselves also, I can talk about myself. I have at least 2-3 bank accounts. Yep. I would have at least 2 credit cards. UPI to chodo. UPI is more a mode of payment rather than a product per se. I don't know. People probably have loans also. So if I look at the financial product footprint, it's got at least 10, 15 things depending on person to person. You would have loans. You would have a car loan. You would have a house loan. You could have insurance. So you want to just talk about it because I think this sounds damn interesting. Yeah,
this has been actually our thought process from day one. And I know that that's also a reason as to why we named our company. So our holding company name is EpiFi. Epi is the Greek word, which means the center, and Phi is finance. And our vision essentially has always been that, it's not about a singular payment product or a singular bank account. If you really want to help people across their finances, then it's plural, right? You need to bring all of it together. And that's the moment of truth. If you're able to give consumers a unified experience, a unified bank statement, an understanding of money in its nuanced form, that's going to be brilliant. We think that over the next 2-3 months, this is going to be a game changer in India. Just like how UPI opened up payments across the board. So you'll actually see, this ecosystem taking shape. RBI is supportive of it. There's a lot of players working on the account aggregator ecosystem. So it's just a matter of time, for instance, when this comes. And we think that we'll be ahead of the curve. And this is the next wave of finance taking a leap forward.
Yeah. I mean, for example, why do I need to get reminders from the product providers for me when I make the payment? I should get from the bank probably, because yep. I'll get a payment saying your car insurance is due and that will come from the insurance provider, and that, you know, that is then accompanied by five different levels of spam, because I've got all insurance companies knowing that my car insurance is due. That's a big headache for me. But you guys actually think this is possible? You know, this would change a lot of things here.
Yep. So I think by the time this episode is beamed, I think you'll have this product live.
I like that. I like the under the hood and the stuff, secret stuff out there. But I, you know, which is why I'm hoping that you guys can come back, you know, say after 6 months, and we'll have a lot more to talk about. Okay. Just wrapping up the episode now. Savings bank account interest rate has become a thing for a lot of people. I think somewhere maybe a year or so, whenever it was, that banks started to compete on interest rates, especially the newer banks. They obviously wanted CASA, and then therefore to attract that, you know, to attract those deposits, they would offer higher interest rates. So what are your views on the interest rate being a thing, right? And what do you offer?
So interesting, right? Like I was around when the interest savings account interest rate deregulation happened, and banks were free to open up this. And what we noticed essentially at that point of time a few years ago was that all of the new entrants, as you rightly said, as a land grab, started offering higher interest rate. After a year or two, for instance, of garnering customers, they would revert back into a base rate, and then there would be some new bank entering the space. One of the things that we realized is that very few people actually close their existing bank account and migrated, right? I've had the same bank account for 15 years. A lot of people do that. Whereas it's vastly different for new consumers entering the market, for instance, they tend to choose whatever, you know, higher interest rates are there. What we wanted to do is that we realized that today the quantum of money lying in a savings account is perhaps higher than even the quantum of money lying in mutual funds, for instance, right? People just put their money in a savings account and think that it's perfectly fine. So one of the things that we actually did is that we said, savings account interest rates keep fluctuating. Could we actually create a sweep product, you know, beyond the savings rate? Because A, people want that liquidity in the savings account, and then they compartmentalize money into an FD, into an RD, into mutual funds, into stocks, into different things. But we wanted to build that behavior of people actually moving money away from a savings account into a slightly higher yield account. So we worked with our partner bank, which is Federal, that we launched this feature with. And we said, can we take a step back and look at it from a consumer perspective? Consumers set an FD, which is a very old school product, but Indians are conservative. That's the first product that we prefer taking. But we put aside only money that we are willing to lock up. The second product that people choose is either a SIP or an RD, right? Where every month you sign up for a X amount. And users there also tend to then opt for a smaller amount than what they actually can do, right? So we said, can we bring the best of both worlds? Can we create higher interest rates like FDs, but ensure that users understand that this is a sweep kind of a service? Two, not have a fixed amount. So can it be that you put in from 50 rupees to 50,000, for instance, as and when you want? And in certain months, you don't put in that money also, it's perfectly fine, right? So we created a product called Smart Deposit. Interest rates, I think, are interesting, but we've got to start moving people into a slightly differentiated behavior. And I see this as a learning curve even for the normal user. Move from savings interest rate, go into a higher yield product, then again take it to a maybe index funds, then take it to slightly more riskier products that people can actually do. Our partner bank, at least Federal, they operate, you know, they're one of the few banks that have their savings account rate linked to the repo rate, right? So it offers between 2.5 to 2.75% right now is the base rate, which is like all old large banks in India offer. But the smart deposit product that we offer has about 5.1% as the interest rate, right? And our point with consumers is create more and more smart deposits. There's, you know, no withdrawal penalties. There's no amount for you to put in every month. That becomes interesting. And I think that's the key, right? Can we look at consumer behavior and create products, whether it's on the mutual fund side, whether it's on the deposit side, for instance, which are slightly more conservative, right, as a starting point, and then go into with your risk profile, maybe start dabbling into into slightly more riskier products over a period of time. But I think, Anupam, you're going to see this in the market as newer and newer banks come. Interest rates will be high, then they will taper down. Somebody else will come in. It's a nice way to lock up customers initially. We actually want to go a step beyond that and say that we are a partner for the next multiple years with you, right? And bring in a suite of products that we think will make sense.
I wish I could make a checklist of features in a bank account that you should look forward for. These days, honestly, if your net banking is working, by that's good enough for me, man. The stuff that's happened in banking in the last 1 year. Anyway, okay. Just to clarify to our listeners, guys, could you just tell us about what is the relationship between FI and Federal? How does that work? Because you said your partner bank is Federal Bank and you are FI. So, you know, the two separate entities. How does that work? Because, you know, it's just that people would want to know that what if tomorrow that relationship ends? So first, What is the nature of the relationship and what could happen theoretically if that is not there?
No, absolutely. I think safety, security, trust become very, very important for consumers when they look at money, right? In this case, we are no different than how a GPay or a PhonePay, for instance, operates. They work with a partner bank to bring their services live to consumers. Make no mistake, we are not a bank. We don't have a banking license. So all of the money that consumers deposit actually lies with our partner bank out here, which is Federal. So technically, none of us have any access. It's absolutely following RBI's guidelines, from a safety and a security perspective. Consumers, even today, they don't have to wait for something untoward to happen, which we don't think so will happen. But even today, a consumer can either walk into a bank branch or even access net banking, mobile banking that the bank offers. But if they want a slightly differentiated experience, for instance, that's why they come into FI, because they're not getting the vanilla experience that you'd tend to get with a normal bank account, for instance. So for consumers, your money is safe. If tomorrow, even if we don't exist, your bank account exists, right? India is one of the few places where the government, the regulator, are obsessed about the safety of money from a consumer perspective, and so are we, right? We are also equally obsessed about it. So 200% your money is safe, regardless of a fintech being there or not. The money lies with a bank, who we partner with. And over a period of time, we'll have multiple banking partners that we sign up with. So consumers can choose which bank that they want to partner with, or the underlying bank that they want to use. But the experience, customer service, the debit card, the offers, the rewards, the tech, all of that is something that we bring forward for consumers.
And that's really exciting. And I hope that there is no competition in the kind of products and services that banks offer, even if it's a neobank, because the technology is something that would come as a breath of fresh air, at least as far as banking experience goes. Talking about a time where, you know, I don't know if you guys remember, to open a bank account, you need a referral, right? You need to know someone, and then that guy, you have to go to the branch and then sign up, and that guy would probably have to vouch for you and stuff like that. But just, you know, last question, where do you see the banking experience going forward 3 years, 5 years? What do you think is going to transform in India? Let's talk at a user experience level. What do you think is going to happen?
So, you know, a few things, right? And we keep debating, we keep talking about this, we keep trying to look into the future and say that, you know, how do we see this actually panning out? I think, one, we're going to see the power of personalization really come into fore as far as banking experiences are. Today, whether you're 16 or you're 60, you're salaried, you're self-employed, you're a risk taker, you're highly conservative, your banking experience remains the same. Right? Gone are the days where you would go walk into a branch and meet, you know, a branch manager out there who would offer you a cup of tea and then explain something to you. I don't think that's going to happen. So, A, how do you bring the power of personalization, for instance, right? We see this in the world of shopping. When you log into Netflix, what you see and what I see are vastly different. It's based on your choices, your preferences. I think finance has to take that leap forward. It's something that, you know, data science technology today offers, for instance, to customizing products based on consumers, right? There is, I think, more niches will start emerging rather than one size fits all. That, hey, this is a credit card and this is a standard credit card for everyone. I think consumers should be given the choice of being able to drag, drop, and create their own product construct that they'd like. That will be the second big thing that you'll actually see. Three, I think that transparency will take a leap forward, right? Like even for someone as evolved in the world of finance as you, trying to make head or tail about a banking agreement is difficult, right? Like how is a home loan priced? Why does the interest rate move the way that it is? That I think is going to be vastly different over the next 3-4 years. Four, I think is about an integrated experience rather than all of your experiences broken, 3 different bank accounts, 2 credit cards, 3 wallets, 2 UPI apps, 2 insurance, 4 mutual funds. I think that's too complex. We've got to simplify, bring it all together for people to make intelligent choices about money, because it is amongst, you know, I won't say it's the most important thing, but it allows you to get things that are important to you over a period of time. And for today's generation, for instance, who wants financial freedom and wants to retire early and, you know, not work till superannuation, for instance, you know, this has to be an important choice that they make.
Sujit, I wish I was evolved. I'm not as evolved as you make me sound out to be. Last year in the middle of pandemic and lockdown, I was struggling to change my bank account for my mutual fund there. So face shield, face mask, laga ke I was roaming around for...
Think about it, right? The only time a lot of us would have gone to a bank account is when we had to travel abroad, and for your visa, you need a bank statement with a seal. I mean, today's day and age, I mean, there are better ways to authenticate and get a genuine bank statement out to your visa processing team, for instance. So I think one bright side of the pandemic is that we've all realized to operate in a near digital experience, even for things that we took for granted in the offline world. So yeah, a lot of changes, hopefully.
It's not just bank statement. Sometimes whoever these people are, pata nahi, you know, as the meme says, kaun hai ye log, kahan se aate hai ye log? They want bank account letterhead. They want bank seal. Okay, that rubber stamp.
Yeah.
They want the bank manager's signature. And they want his bank membership number or some such stuff. Okay, so that is the level of detail. Anyway, Sumit, I'm going to have you, you know, I want you to have the last word here as I wrap up. Being, you mentioned about how you were part of the whole Google bar development phase. So from a technology perspective, how do you think this is going to change the way we as, you know, we as individuals relate to our money? You know, whether it's at a bank account or whether it's an investment or any requirement. I'll give you an example. Like, do you think that this, I can actually be at some point in my experience with a bank, say that your app, I can actually type in a search bar, can I buy a house? ? What do I need to, you know, go for a foreign vacation? Do you think that this is actually possible?
Next year.
I like the 2-word answer to my 40-word question. So come right on, talk to us more, please. Go on.
So, you know, I think that's definitely possible. Right? To me, that's like, you know, once you understand the user and start doing it, these questions are, you know, to me, possible in the technology that exists today, right? Yeah. Yes, the key is, you know, Sujit said building trust, but like from a tech perspective, where you really want to go is, can you go a step further, right? Like, what do I need to do if the answer to the question is, can I get a house today is no, what do I need to do to get a house in a year or two? And with what risk percentage, right? Like, and I think, can you get there? Can you understand your ease of use? Right? Let's be sure. The goal of a financial app is to get out of the way of the user and let them enjoy their life, right? So can we really make it that good that we are actually doing the work and getting out so that let people enjoy? Your life is short. Right. You got to do what you want to do. Ensure that there are technology out there to help your life.
And that is something, you know, just imagine, hey, you're out for a weekend and hopefully someday when things are back to normal and you overspend on your credit card and you've actually got a notification that stops you from doing that. Well, that would be something really interesting here. You think technology can do that for you?
Yes.
Right?
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, nice. I think so. You can set limits for your weekends, right? And I think that's the way that we see it, saying that, hey, Anupam, on weekends, you tend to spend so much. So how about for this weekend, we cap your transactions at a max of this amount. Tech can help creating that. Now, if the user wants to circumvent it, obviously there's ways to do it. But yeah, I mean, that's the way that we see, saying that all of the things that we say about nudges, positive actions that users can take, I think tech can help build that. And that's the future that we see. We see it as being bright in helping users reach their aspirations and goals.
Yeah, man. Yes. If they can even stop me that maybe that I've had one drink too many and I suddenly go to the ATM and I put my credit card instead of my debit card to withdraw money, some kind of notification on my phone that goes boom. Hold on there, my friend. You know, you're going to get tired. Anyway, let's hope that all of that is possible sometime in the future. And talking about future, guys, please come back, you know, maybe after 6 months and once your product is up and ready and tell us how the journey is. Who knows? In the next 3 months, 6 months, if regulation also changes. You spoke about the account aggregator. I remember I'd taken Paisa Vaisa on the road. I'd gone to Delhi. I'd met Amit Ranjan, and that, you know, he's the architect of DigiLocker. Spoke about the account aggregator at that point of time. I really hope that happens soon. I don't know where this entire thing got lost, but that could change things, right? The account aggregator.
Definitely huge hopes on that, right? Like, and I actually expect, like, you know, what UPI did, account aggregator has, you know, similar potential.
Lovely. So folks, on that note of hope, optimism, and a lot of expectations from the future for our financial experience, that is a wrap on this episode of Paisa Paisa. I guess the founders of Fi, sorry, I called it Fi at the starting of the episode. My bad. Fi Neobank, Sujit Narayanan and Sumit Kualani. Sumit, guys, thank you so much for doing this for our listeners.
Thank you so much. Delighted to be here. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thanks for having us.
And folks, now the credit privilege tip of the week. Have goals. Have financial goals. Just like you have goals in your life, have financial goals also. And try to make them, you know, size them in a way that you can achieve them. Maybe it could be for a foreign vacation, something that you dream. It could be for retirement, which is a longer term plan. But having goals is really important to developing a financial plan so that you can achieve these goals over a period of time by investing accordingly. Right? We work really, really hard for your money. We just keep on spending or investing without any goals, you know, short term or long term. Things can get a bit tough. So that's your credit privilege tip of the week. Have goals, even if the bite-sized one, for your finances.
And thank you, listeners, for listening to this episode. If you're enjoying this show, please do share it with your friends, family, and people that you know. That would be really helpful for us. You can listen to this show and other interesting shows on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. You can also follow us on our social media. We are IVM Podcast on Twitter and Instagram. And if you want to reach out to me, I'm your host, Anupam Gupta, B50 on Twitter and B_50 on Instagram. Thank you so much for listening to Paisa Paisa, presented by Cred, the most rewarding credit card bill payments app, and powered by Quantum.
No material on the show should be considered as financial advice. The material on the show is for informational purposes only. Please consult a financial advisor before taking any investment decision.
Hi, everybody. Just wanted to ask everyone for a quick favor. We're running a brand survey right now and would really appreciate it if you could let us know what you think about the advertising on IVM. Go to ivmpodcast.com/survey and do let us know. As part of this, we'll be selecting 10 random participants and sending them some IVM swag. So do fill out those surveys. Hey, everybody, it's been a great week on the IVM Podcast Network. On a show about crypto, Rohan Joshi is joined by Jayanti Kanani, co-founder and CEO of Matic Network, to discuss crypto and blockchain inventions in India. On Audio Gyan, Kedar and Avinit talk to one of India's most experienced designers, Rush Bhatt, the co-founder of ClearTrip. On The Longest Constitution, Priya takes us through religious personal laws and the criminalization of triple talaq. On Nyata, Anirudh tells us how the Mughals transformed from a warband into an empire. Why is cringe-watching so addictive and viral? On Smarter with Sid, Siddharth covers cringe-watching from four perspectives: creators, individuals, communities, and brands. Do follow us on social media. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And remember, if you're enjoying this show or any of other shows for that matter, please do tell a friend. And finally, we'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Cred, Bank of Baroda, Quarter, CoinSwitch Kuber, Slay Coffee, Intel, Kotak Mahindra Bank, and Oxfam India. Thank you so much for making this possible.
If you're a cricket fan, check out Edges and Sledges, India's favorite cricket podcast.
The podcast focuses on Indian cricket, the IPL, and has a ton of banter both on and off the field.
We talk about the week's biggest cricket stories with current and ex-international cricketers, coaches, or sometimes just between us.
And it's hosted by me, DJ.
Me, Varun.
And me, Ashwin.
New episodes release every week.
You can catch us on the IVM Podcasts website, app,
or wherever you get your podcasts from.
Check out the Edges and Sledges Cricket Podcast.